العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، so we'll carry on with the book of Sheikh Abdussalam Burgess رحمة الله عليه رحمة واسعة، أصول الدعوة السلفية، the fundamentals of الدعوة السلفية. We've now reached the fifth أصل. The first أصل was العلم أو الاهتمام بالعلم، giving importance to علم. Learning and studying the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second was al-amal bihi, yani acting upon and adhering to the knowledge that one has learned. The third was ad-da'watu ila Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after learning and acting upon the knowledge that Allah has taught an individual, then they call towards the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth asal was al-ihtimam bil-aqidah, al-ihtimamu bil-aqidati salafiyya, giving importance to the aqidah of the salaf, giving importance to the correct Islamic creed and belief. The fifth asal, which we'll study today, is al-ihtimamu bil-sunnati nabawiyya, giving great importance and concern to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wal-hirsu al-amali biha, and applying it and being diligent in applying it and acting upon it. وَالدَّعْوَةُ إِلَىٰ ذَلِكَ, and calling towards the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As usual, as is the norm, we have to know the connection between the title of the book, which is أُصُولُ دَعْوَةِ السَّلَفِيَّةِ, and the أَصَّلَ at hand. And that is something that the student of knowledge should always know, even when studying other books. For example, Kitab al-Tawheed. It's important that the student knows the connection between the title Kitab al-Tawheed and every chapter that Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahmatullahi alayhi brings. And likewise, for example, when you see the Muhaddithun, the book Bab Kada wa Kada, and then the Ahadith are narrated, Hadith after Hadith, you have to understand the mahallu shahid. Where is the sheikh using, or the author, what is he using as evidence from this hadith? Because he could bring a long hadith, lacking the evidence is probably in one line or one sentence of that hadith. So what is the connection between giving importance to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and usulu da'wati salafiyya? In other words, why is this khas? And why is this specific to Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah? Why is this from the characteristics, specific characteristics of Ad-Da'wah As-Salafiyyah? As we said, all of the conditions and foundations, all of the foundations that the Sheikh will mention are specific to Da'wah As-Salafiyyah. So what makes Da'wah As-Salafiyyah specific when it comes to implementing the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The answer is the Ahlus Sunnah or As-Salafiyyun, they give importance and they give precedence to the wordings of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they do not put forward opinions of men, however noble they may be, however regardless of this, of their status and their level of knowledge, they do not put the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam behind or after the wordings of men. Likewise, when it comes to intellect, if the intellect or the aql contradict a hadith from the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ahlus Sunnah give precedence to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because it is a wahy, it is a revelation from Allah jalla wa ala. Allah jalla wa ala says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Verily, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't talk from desires and whims, like it is revelation. So when it comes to what is used as evidence or what is considered as evidence, the Salafiyun, Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah, they say Al-Qur'an was Sunnah, the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب. As for those groups that oppose the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they are not on that pattern, or they do not adopt this methodology. For example, the Mu'tazila, or the Asha'ira, or Ahlul Kalam, those that busy themselves with philosophy. When they hear the words of the hadiths of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, so they hear hadith from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if this hadith contradicts their beliefs and their way of thinking, then they reject the hadith, sometimes by interpreting it in an incorrect manner, or sometimes by saying this is a hadith al-ahad, this is a hadith which doesn't have a lot of narrators in its chains of narration, therefore we're not going to accept it, and so on. So مثلاً, when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, ينزل ربنا كل ليلة إلى سماء الدنيا, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in an authentic hadith narrated by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi, narrated by Imam Muslim, he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the lowest heaven every night when there's a third left after the last, during the last third of the night. Tayyib. Let's look at how Ahlul Sunnah implement this hadith and how Ahlul Kalam or the Asha'ir and these deviant groups implement this hadith. Ahlul Sunnah, they say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the lowest heaven of every night when there's a third left of the night, or the last third of the night, as it is in the hadith. So their belief is in coincides with and is in accordance with the ahadith, with the words of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Lakin the Mu'tazila, the Jahmiyyah, the Asha'ira, and so on, they say la. They say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't descend. Lakin the angels descend. Or they say Amru Rabbik, or the Amr, the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't descend. So look how they contradicted the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And why is that? In vain of what? They say that if we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends, then who is up in the throne when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends? Or they say if it's the last third of the night for those living in Europe, for example, or those living in the UK, for example, then for those living in a different part of the world, it's not the last third of the night, it's daytime. So are you saying that Allah descends constantly, more than yani constantly descending? So they use their intellect and their aql to reject the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So that's where they have deviated from the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Mathal in the Khawarij, those who kill the Muslims, and those who rebel against the rulers, and those who rebelled against the messengers, the Sahaba, and those who killed the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they rejected and they did not give importance to the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So method and those ahadith that deal with or that mention that even if a person falls into a sin they can go into Jannah, they reject all of those ahadith, and they say that if a person falls into sin, then they are kuffar, they have disbelieved, they have apostated from the religion of Islam, and they will remain in the fire for eternity. And based on that, they fought the Messenger, the Sahaba, the companions of the Messenger, eventually killing Uthman and other noble companions, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. Likewise, if we look into the ahadith, the jama'at of today, the groups or parties of today, the Islamic organizations who associate themselves with the religion, although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have prohibited dividing the Muslims and us differing and having groups and so on, they negate or they refute the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So مثلاً, when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says alaykum bis-sam'i wa-ta'a, or when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when the Sahaba say bay'ana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam ala sam'i wa-ta'a fi manshatina wa makrahina wa usrina wa yusrina, we gave allegiance to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam to always give obedience, to hear and obey in that which we favor, in that which we love, and that which we hate, in times of ease and in times of difficulty. When they hear these ahadith, which are bilisan arabiyyin mubin, in the language of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the language of the Arabs, clear Arabic, they say la. These ahadith are, sometimes they say they're weak, and for those that are in Bukhari and Muslim, they interpret them into a way or in a way which conforms or goes in accordance with their evil belief and their evil methodology. So they reject the hadith of the messenger. So when you say, the messenger said that in the hadith al-Iqbad, alaykum bisam'i wa ta'a, they say, la, fulan ibn fulan kharaj ala fulan. This individual done khuruj. Sa'id ibn Jubayr done khuruj. Abdullah ibn Zubayr done khuruj. Hussein radiallahu anhu done khuruj. Fulan min al-nas done khuruj. Tayyib. So they say, are you saying that these companions and these noble salaf, they contradicted the hadith of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when in reality they don't have evidence to go against these ahadith of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There's levels to evidence. So mathalan, there's a hadith, there's a Quran and the sunnah, then ijma and qiyas and so on, and qawl al-sahabi, that statement of the sahabi comes way down in the list, to the extent that many of the madhahib don't even take it as a hujjah. Like, if that is the statement of the companion, how about the action of the companion? How about an action of the tabi'i? So look at these clear-cut ahadith and look at how these hizbiyun and these takfiris, they reject these ahadith of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They do tawaf around ijma' and there's ijma' or there isn't ijma' and there's khilaf in the matter and so on. Ya akhi, if the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives you a clear-cut hadith, where does the khilaf come from? Where does the khilaf come from? So with these ahadith, when you look at these, you find that the only people that give importance to the sunnah of the messenger are Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, are the Salafiyun. Likewise, there's a group called the Quraniyun who reject the ahadith of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They say, whatever we find in the Quran of Allah, we take it. And whatever we don't find in the Quran of Allah, then we leave it alone. Lakin in reality, that's only a claim and they haven't implemented the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's the connection between Usul al-Da'wah al-Salafiyyah, the title, and the Asl at hand. Tayyib. The next thing is, the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a source of tashri', is a source for legislation. It's a reference point for legislation. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Verily the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't talk from revelation. He talks, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't talk from desires and whims. He talks from revelation. So everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is revelation. So the sunnah is a mustang and it is a reference point for the Muslims to take their sharia from. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. Verily I have been given the Qur'an, I have been given the kitab, and the like of it, which is the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there is no way a person can implement the sharia of Islam without the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So mathalan, al-zakah, how does a person pay zakah? You will only find that in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's the amount that is meant to be paid in zakah? How does a person perform wudu? How does a person pray? How many rak'at? How does a person perform hajj? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said with regards to salah, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli, pray as you have seen me pray. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said when it comes to hajj, khudu anni manasikakum, take from me your manasik or the way to perform hajj. So that is from the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there are many ibadat that are clarified by the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the extent that a person would not be able to implement Islam without the sunnah. Mathalan, those things that nullify fasting. The sunan of fasting, the wajibat of fasting, you will only find that in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And even some issues to do with inheritance, you will only find that in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next point, before we start the words of the Shaykh rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatan wasi'a, is what is the connection between the Quran and the Sunnah? What is the connection between the Quran and the Sunnah? The scholars have divided the relationship or the connection between the Quran and the Sunnah into different types. The first category is that the Sunnah is mu'akkidah. It affirms that which has been narrated in the, that has been mentioned in the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mathalan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, wa aqimu as-salah wa atu zakah. Establish the prayer and pay the zakah. in this verse, we see that zakah is wajib and salah is wajib. Likewise, in many other hadith, we find that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that zakah is wajib and that salah is wajib. مثلا the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar, Buni al-Islam ala khams. Islam has been built upon five. He mentioned sallallahu alaihi wasallam the shahadatain, the salah, and zakah and hajj and fasting and so on. So sometimes the sunnah reaffirms and confirms that which has been mentioned in the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, sometimes the Quran is mustaqilla, the sunnah is mustaqilla, ahkamun mustaqilla. It comes with a legislation in and of itself, which is separate from the Quran of the Quran. So this hukum, you will only find it in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For example, the inheritance of the jadda, the grandmother, what does she inherit? You will only find that in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why when a mas'ala, when an issue came with someone who died, when they came to Abu Bakr with regards to the grandmother, what she inherits, he did not know radiallahu anhu. And he asked some of the other companions, and it was Mughira ibn Shu'bah radiallahu anhu and other companions that told him, Abu Bakr, يعني, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a sudus also to the grandmother. طيب. Also, there are other ahadi ahkam. مثلا, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا تُنْكَحُ الْمَرَةُ بِعَمَّتِهَا وَمَعَ عَمَّتِهَا أُخَالَتِهَا كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. When it comes to nikah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a woman is not married with her auntie, or paternal aunt or maternal aunt. Meaning that if you marry a woman, you cannot marry her auntie, nor can you from the mother's side, nor can you marry your auntie from her mathalan, her father's side. So you can't marry her auntie or the, her khala, the amma or the khala. You will only find that hukum in the messenger, sunnah of the messenger. So if you say you're not going to implement the sunnah of the messenger, or if you say it's not important, then that hukum won't apply to you and you will fall into sin. Also, the messenger, sallallahu, from the connection is that the sunnah is a mubayyin. It clarifies the mujmal of the Quran. That which has been mentioned in general in the Quran, which there's some sort of ambiguity surrounding in the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, مثلا, the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how to pray, how many rak'ah to pray. If you were to look into the Quran from Fatiha to Nas, you won't find how many rak'ah to pray. You won't for Dhuhr, for Isha, for Fajr, two, and so on. You won't find it except in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then, ahyan, and sometimes it comes to the sunnah restricts that which has been mentioned in the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muqayyida li sunnah. It restricts that which has been mentioned in the Quran and it hasn't been restricted. For example, the qad', the cutting of the hand. Allah Jalla wa Ala mentions that the thief, the male and the female, their hands should be chopped off. طيب, where do we chop? Do we chop it from there? Do we chop it from the elbow? Do we chop it from the hand? The sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarified that it's this part that gets chopped off if the conditions are met. طيب. أحيانا, and sometimes the fifth one is that it is مخصصة. It specifies that which has been mentioned in the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مثلا, we find in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the children inherit their parents. يُسِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ لِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلَ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the awlad, the children, they inherit their parents. طيب. Lakin, we find in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that generality has been specified at times. مثلا, لا يرث القاتل. The one who kills the person that he's meant to inherit, he won't inherit him. So if a son kills his father, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ, then he won't inherit him. You won't find that hukum in the sunnah, in the Quran of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And likewise, if there's ikhtilaf fi deen, and if one is a Muslim and one is a non-Muslim, they won't inherit one another. You won't find that hukum except in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tayyib, let's move over to, let's now start the words of the Shaykh rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatan wasi'a. Qala Shaykh Abdul Salam rahmatullahi alayhi, inna ahaqa ma'atana bihi al-Muslim. Verily, the most important and most deserving issue that the Muslim gives great attention to, al-amalu ala iqtifai athari nabiyhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa tajseediha fi hayatihi mastata'a ila dhalika sabila. The most important thing that a Muslim can give importance to is following the example of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and making sure that he's embodied into his everyday life as much as the person is able to do so. وذلك لأن الغاية التي يسعى المسلم لأجلها إنما هي تحصيل الهداية التي توصل إلى دار السعادة. Verily, that which, or the most primary act that the Muslim strives for, it strives because of it, is to attain guidance in the dunya, that guidance which leads to happiness, the guidance which leads to happiness. And that guidance is only found in the sun, in following the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَقَدْ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَإِن تُطِيعُوهُ تَهْتَدُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you obey the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, تَهْتَدُوا, then you will be guided. وَقَالَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى وَاتَّبِعُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. Follow him, meaning follow the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ, so that you may be guided. وَقَالَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. Verily, in the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is a good guidance. There is upright guidance in the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But for who? لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. The one that hopes in the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that hopes to meet Allah jalla wa ala, and the one that hopes for yawm al-qiyamah, meaning happy having a good ending yawm al-qiyamah. وهذه الآية أصل كبير في تأسي برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بأقواله وأفعاله وجميع أحواله وحركاته وسكناته. And this verse is a tremendous foundation for following example of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his statements, in his actions, and in every aspect of his life, in every aspect of the life of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وهذه الأسوة إنما يسلكها ويوفق لها من كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر. Verily, with regards to this example of following the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one that follows it is the one that has been guided, that has been given the tawfiq, that he hopes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's meeting, and he hopes in yawm al-qiyamah. For verily, that which is with him, or that which he possesses from iman, wa khawfi Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa raja'i thawabihi, wa khawfi aqabihi, from fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fear that he has in Allah, the hope that he has in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the fear that he has in the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of this, يحثه على التأسي برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. All of this incites and encourages him to follow the guidance of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشرف المؤمن ومنزلته إنما تقاس باتباعه صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the nobility of the mu'min, the nobility of the believer, and his status is only, or it depends on how he follows the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. فكلما كان تحريه للسنة أكثر, so the more he follows the example of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كان للدرجات العلا أحق وأولى, then he is more, or the more he implements the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the higher he is elevated in levels and ranks. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu used to say, لا يزال الناس على الطريق ما اتبعوا الأثر. The people will not cease to be upon the guidance, the tariq of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for as long as they follow the author, the narrations of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلِذَا كَانَ السَّلَفُ السَّابِقُونَ مِنَ التَّابِعِينَ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِمْ يَجْعَلُونَ الْمِعْيَارَ الَّذِي يُؤْخَذُ بِهِ عَنِ الرَّجُلِ الْعِلْمُ هُوَ تَمَسُّكُهُ بِالسُّنَّةِ. So the Salaf rahmatullahi alayhim, for this reason, they would, or the criterion or the benchmark for them taking knowledge from a certain person would be depending on his holding on to the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if he was a person who would implement the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was apparent from his guidance and his appearance, then they would take and seek knowledge from him. كما قال إبراهيم النخعي رحمة الله عليه. Ibrahim Nakhai said, who was a tabi'i from the students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, كانوا, يعني the Salaf, they were, إذا أتوا رجل, if they came to a man, ليأخذوا عنه العلم, so that they wanted to, or if they wanted to take knowledge from a person, نظروا إلى صلاته, they would look at his salah. How would he pray? Would he pray in accordance with the sunnah of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم? وإلى سنته, and the sunnah of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, would he pray according to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa ila hayatihi and his appearance, thumma ya'khudhuna anhu. Then they would take from him. So they wouldn't just seek knowledge from anyone. They would only seek knowledge from the person whose appearance is in accordance with the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is extremely important. This is especially in this day of age, in this day that we live in this era, whereby you will find a person saying they're calling to the Sharia of Islam. They're calling to the guide, they're saying they're calling to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the religion of Allah in general. And they're saying they're scholars or they're du'at. Like when you look at them, there's no sign that they follow the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they may shave their beards, for example. Or when you look at their haircuts, they've got different levels and qaz', which is haram in the Sharia of Islam. When you look at their appearance, they probably got suits on and ties on, and they don't have the outward appearance of a person who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of a person who, I shouldn't say fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that's the heart of the action. Lakin, they don't have the outward appearance of a person who's following the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So it's important that if a person is calling to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they have to at least look the part. They have to look as if they are calling to the Messenger sallallahu, as if they are implementing the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Likewise, you will find people that are calling or claim to be calling to the sunnah of the Messenger or calling to Islam, lakin they are calling to the people upon lying, or that you catch them lying, or they are deceiving people and so on. Or they are using words that are not appropriate, that are not befitting for a Muslim to be using. So when a person is calling to the way of Allah Jalla wa'ala, they have to look like they are implementing the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, just like the Salaf used to. Sometimes the Salaf would come to a person, travel after traveling miles and miles, maybe days, they would come to a person, and if they saw that he wasn't a person who can be, wasn't a person who followed the sunnah of the Messenger, they would leave him, although they traveled for days, maybe even weeks. ويقول أحد العلماء, and some of the scholars, one of the scholars said, إن من علامات الحب لله سبحانه وتعالى, the verily the signs of a person who loves the Messenger, loves Allah سبحانه وتعالى, متابعة حبيب الله سبحانه وتعالى, him, the sign is following the one that Allah سبحانه وتعالى loves. So a sign of you loving Allah is you following the Messenger of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. في أخلاقه وأفعاله وأوامره وسننه وسننه, in following the Messenger's behavior, his character, his actions, his commandments, and his sunnah, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. وَهَذَا حَقٌ مَأْخُوذٌ, and that is taken from the statement of Allah, min kitab Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah jalla wa ala says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, say, verily, if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow me, meaning follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What will happen? يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ, Allah jalla wa ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. And وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you for the sins that you have fallen into. قال الحسن البصري رحمة الله عليه في تفسير هذه الآية, حسن البصري, who was one of the Salaf, one of the Tabi'un, he said, جَعَلَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَلَامَةَ حُبِّهِمْ إِيَّاهُ اتِّبَاعَ سُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the proof of them loving, their proof for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their proof that they love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was what? Them following the sunnah of the Messenger salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. يقول الشيخ عبد السلام رحمة الله عليه, الشيخ عبد السلام said, فَلَقَدْ تَوَاتَرَتِ النُّصُوصُ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ وَأَقْوَالِ الصُّحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ عَلَى تَرْغِيبِ الْعَمَلِ بِسُنَّةِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَالْحَثِّ عَلَى التَّمَسُّكِ بِهَا. There are numerous narrations and numerous verses from the Quran of Allah, numerous texts from the Quran of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the statements of the Sahaba in encouraging people to follow the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and holding on to it. ومن أشهر الأحاديث, and from the most famous ahadith, is Hadith al-Iqbad, Iqbad ibn Sari radiallahu anhu, in which he said, أَنَّهُ قَالَ وَعَذَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَمْ مَوْعِذَةً ظَرَفَتْ مِنْهَا الْعُيُونَ. This Sahabi, he narrated a hadith in which he said that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم gave a maw'idah. He gave an emotional or moving speech to the companions in which their eyes flowed with tears. ووجلت منها القلوب, and their hearts trembled out of fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of fear of what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying. فقلنا يا رسول الله, we said, يا رسول الله, كإنها, إن هذه موعدة مودع, أو يا رسول الله, it seems like a farewell statement, it feels like a farewell نصيحة. فأوصنا, give us counsel, give us advice, يا رسول الله. قال تركتكم على البيضاء ليلها كالنهارها لا يزيغ عنها بعد إلا هالك. I have left upon you a clear path, a clear path. Its night is like its day, meaning everything that I've left is clear. I've left with you the sunnah, يعني, the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Quran of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is clear. The one that deviates from it, there is none that deviates from it except that they are doomed. وَمَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. And the one that lives long amongst you shall see much differing. So what should they do? The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي, upon you is my sunnah. Hold on to my sunnah. وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. And also hold on to the sunnah of the Mahdiyeen, the Khulafa al-Rashideen after me. عَضُّ عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدِ. And hold on to it with the nawajid. Hold on to it with your mawlati. This is an example, a qiyas or analogy where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, hold on to, he's saying, hold on to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tightly and do not let go, regardless of what happens, regardless of what situation you find yourself in, regardless of the fitan and the differing that you find amongst you, then hold on to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashidun, the sunnah of the rightly guided caliphs of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali radiallahu anhu, and the guidance of the companions radiallahu ta'ala alayhim. There's a fa'idah here which some of the scholars mentioned. They say, alayha, addu alayha, hold on to it. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned two sunnahs. عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين. Hold on to my sunnah and the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashidin. So why did the Messenger say in the end, hold on to it? It being what? Some of the scholars say that the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the sunnah of the companions is one. And some say that this goes back to the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashidun. The sunnah of those of Umar, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and so on, radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. And the Messenger did not repeat following his sunnah because it's well known amongst all of the Muslims. Like in the khilaf happens in following the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is not hard to understand because when you find the khilaf in this ummah, when did it happen? It happened during the time of the companions. During the time of the Sahaba. So, مثلا, the Khawarij, they went to a place called Harura. They went to a place which was far from where the companions were. The Jama'ah of the Muslims, they left the Jama'ah of the Muslims and they went to a far off place. طيب. And when they wanted to fight or they fought Ali radiallahu anhu and the other companions. Now, why did they fight these companions? When Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, when Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu went to them, what did he use as a hujjah? He said to them, verily, these are the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I have come to you from the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there is not one of them, not one of these companions, not one of those who witnessed the revelation coming down upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was with the Khawarij. So they clearly opposed the hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, alaykum bi sunnati wa sunnati al-khulafai rashidin, and the sunnah of the Khulafai rashidin. Aslan, they were fighting the Khulafai rashidin. They killed Umar, and you've got Uthman Ali radiallahu anhu on the other side. So they are opposing the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just like I said in the introduction, the Khawarij did not give importance to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, they said and they declared the Sahaba to be kuffar and to have opposed the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So look at what Abdullah ibn Abbas used as a hujjah. Likewise, when there were a group of people making tasbih in the masjid, astaghfirullah, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, gathered around in a group, and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, he saw them, he went back to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and he said, Ya Aba Abdurrahman, adrik al-Ummah, go to the Ummah, give them, rescue the Ummah. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud went to them, and he saw them saying, astaghfirullah, subhanallah, halilu mi'a wa kabbiru mi'a, and so on. What did he say to them? These are the vessels of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They have not yet worn out. They're not torn up. And these are the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Either you are upon a guidance which is more or which is better than theirs, or you are have invented or you are inventing a tariq al-talal, a path of misguidance. And it was the latter, because they could never be upon a guidance better than the guidance of the Messenger salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. And that goes throughout history. When Imam Ahmad rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatan wasi'a was debating the Mu'tazila, he would come with qala Allah, qala Rasul. And the Mu'tazila would say, the aql, our intellect doesn't accept this hadith. And he would say to them, ma indi ghayra hada, I have not got anything ghayra hada, then other than the Quran of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Talk to me with qala Allah wa qala Rasul. That is the Salafi. That is the Sunni. He will always say, Ya akhi, come to me with qala Allah wa qala Rasul. As for Fulan said, this individual said, and this one said, and he made khuruj, and he ate this, and he went there. La. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make this wajib upon us to follow, regardless of who it may be. The person who is upon the guidance of the Messenger will always say, قُلْ قَالَ اللَّهُ وَقَالَ رَسُولُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ قَالَ شَيْخ عَبْدِ السَّلَامُ وَقَوْلُهُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ السَّلَامُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ السَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالسُّنَّةِ. And his statement where he says, عَلَيْكُمْ بِالسُّنَّةِ أي بِطَرِيقَتِي بِطَرِيقَتِي الَّتِي أَنَا عَلَيْهَا مِمَّا فَصَّلْتُ لَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَحْكَامِ سواء كانت اعتقادية أو عملية واجبة أو مندوبة. So the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he's saying عليكم بالسنة, it means a hold on to my sunnah, the sunnah that I have clarified upon you, that I have taught you, regardless of whether it may be to do with the belief of the Muslim, or whether it's to do with the actions of the Muslim, the prayer, the hajj, and so on, whether it's wajib or whether it's sunnah, whether it is wajib or whether it's sunnah. And there's a side benefit that we can take from here, which is the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would not look at or they would not ask, is this wajib or is this sunnah? To the companions, their shi'ar and their signpost was, did the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam say this hadith? If the answer was yes, then they would act upon it. So if the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded the Muslims to do this, they wouldn't say, is it sunnah or is it wajib? Likewise, we should have the etiquettes of the companions. We should do exactly what the Sahaba did, which is to take the hadith of the Messenger as it is. We shouldn't say, is it sunnah? Yeah, but is it sunnah though? But yeah, but is it wajib though? Yeah, but am I sinning for not following it? La. The person who loves Allah and loves the Messenger says, سمعت وطعت. I hear and I obey. In one of the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Messenger was in his masjid sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and after the salah, people wanted to leave, and he commanded them to sit down. There was a companion outside of the masjid. He was outside of the masjid, not within the congregation, outside of the masjid. He sat exactly where he was, because the Messenger said, sit. Therefore, he sat where he was. He could have said, I'm going to walk towards the Messenger and sit next to him. Lakin, because he followed the words of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in every detail, he sat where he heard these words. He sat outside the masjid. And there are many ahadith, or the many narrations from the Salaf, in terms of showing how important the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. إمام الشافعي رحمة الله عليه he says أجمع المسلمون على أن من استبانت له سنة من رسول عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يحل له أن يدعها لقول أحد. The Muslims are in agreement. There's a consensus amongst the Muslims that if something has been clarified or mentioned in the Sunnah and it has been authentically narrated in the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it is not permissible for him to leave this off for the statement of anyone, for the statement or the opinion of anyone. Compare the words of Imam al-Shafi'i to those who say, La, this hadith means this and this hadith means that, or this hadith contradicts the aqal. It shows how far they are from the Salaf. Imam Malik, rahmatullah alayhi, who's Imam Dar Hijrah, he was in his masjid, in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the masjid obviously is in Medina. A man came to him and he said to him, I want to make my ihram, ihram meaning the niyyah for nusuk, the hajj that he wants to make. He wants to make this niyyah and this nusuk from the masjid. And we know that the miqat, or the place that the people that live in Medina or whoever comes from their direction, their point or their miqat is the Hulayfa, is a place which is near Medina, on the boundaries, and now maybe even within Medina. That is the point that the Muslim, the Hajj or the Mu'tamir, that's where he makes his Hajj from. So this man came to Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu and he said to him, Ya Imam, I want to make my Umrah from here. Start from here. And you one may say, well, it might even be better because this is the messenger's masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Lakin Imam Malik said to him, La, go to this place. And then the man said to Ya Imam, innama hiya amyalun. Verily, it's only a few miles from here to the miqat. What's the difference? Then Imam Malik said, Akhsha alayka al-fitna. I fear upon you a fitna. And then the man said, Afwan, innama hiya amyalun. Ayyu fitnatin fi hada? What fitna is in this? It's only a few miles. And then the messenger, and then Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi read the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُسِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ وَيُسِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Warn those that oppose his command, meaning the command of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if they do so, that a great fitna and a great punishment will befall them. So look at the istinbad, or how Imam Malik derived this ruling from this verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning if you oppose the Messenger, there's a fitna that will come from it. And look at the state of the Muslims today, the state of the Ummah now. They've opposed the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So mathalan, for example, which is a hot topic, if you look at what they call the Arab Spring, the Kharif al-Arab. If you look at the Muslim countries that have been affected in the Middle East, you will find that the Ummah has been destructed within. It has been destroyed within. After opposing and contradicting the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of the ahadith that relate to hearing and obeying the leader, hearing and obeying the leader. Mathalan, the Sunni, the Salafi will say, "Alaykum bis-sam'i wa ta'a." The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Alaykum bis-sam'i wa ta'a," and he won't say, "Qala Imam Malik," "Qala Imam Ahmed," "Qala Imam Shafi'i," "Qala Imam Abu Hanifa." He will say, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ فِي صَحِيحِ الْبُخَارِ and Muslim. That's the qimma, that's the peak of authenticity in the Sharia of Islam. Bukhari and Muslim. So when the scholars in Mustalah Hadith, when they're talking about in terms of authenticity, they say the most authentic hadith is the hadith that has been narrated by Imam Bukhari and Muslim. And then the hadith that has been narrated by Bukhari alone. And then the hadith that have been narrated by Muslim alone. طيب. The hadith of Sam'i wa Ta'a, we have hadith that are mutafiq alayhi. We have a hadith that have been narrated by Bukhari. We have hadith that have been narrated by Muslim, meaning the peak of authenticity in the Sharia of Islam. So when the Salafi says this, they say, La, you're supporting the Dughat, Al-Aql. Go back to Al-Aql. They say you're supporting oppression, Al-Aql. They say, why don't you ever talk about, or why don't you ever refute the hukam? Why are you always refuting the shu'ub, the people, the common folk? Al-aql. Shuf. And look at what we see in Syria now. When they refuse to take the ahadith of the messenger, forget the Jamia. Leave the Jamia to one side. Imam Muhammad al-Jami, rahmatullahi alayhi, rajul min ahli sunnah, he passed away in the 90s. And he was probably born in the early 50s, maybe late 40s. What was present before Imam Muhammad Aman al-Jami, rahmatullahi alayhi, rahmatullahi wasa'am? These ahadith, were they not in Sahih al-Bukhari? Were they not in Sahih Muslim? Why don't you say Imam Bukhari, Muhammad Ismail Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayhi, was a Jami? Why don't you say Muslim al-Hajjaj and Naysaburi was a Jami? Why don't you say Imam Ahmed was a Jami? Lakin we find that they can't. Because if they do, then people will reject their opinions. Lakin they can easily attract the people by saying Jami said and Jami said. طيب. These ahadith, are they not in the sunnah? Naam, bala. They're in the sunnah of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Are they not authentic? Bala, they're authentic. Naam. طيب. Why don't you implement them, ya ikhwan? Those takfiriyun, those people who oppose the sunnah of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why not implement these ahadith? There's no technicalities to it. Khalil ijma'. There's no technicalities to it. Hadith sahih fil Bukhari, hadith which is authentic and clear in Bukhari. There's no need for ta'wilat. Hate the Jamia as much as you want. It is not wajib upon you to love the Jamia or Sheikh Muhammad Aman al-Jami, rahmatullah alayhi. Lakin it is wajib upon you to follow the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Malik said to a man, if you make your ihram from the masjid, I fear that you will fall into fitna. Why? Because he has opposed the hadith that tells the people, the hujjaj, that their miqat is the place. طيب. How are you now or telling the people to oppose the hadith of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which are greater than where a person can make ihram from? What fitna are you calling the people to? طيب. Also, Sa'id al-Musayyib, rahmatullahi alayhi, rahmatullahi alayhi, he saw a man after, I believe it was after the sunset, or after the Fajr prayer, after they prayed, he was praying sunan. And obviously, as you know, that is the time where it's prohibited for a Muslim to pray. So this Sa'id al-Musayyib, he prevented him from praying. And he said, yeah, the man said to him, yes, Sa'id, am I going to be punished for sujood, for ruku', for praying? Like, Sa'id al-Musayyib said to him, la, you will be punished for opposing the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Tayyib. Imagine those who celebrate the birthday of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Picture those who celebrate the birthday of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Have they implemented the sunnah of the messenger or opposed the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Can it be said that they love the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam? La. Qala Shaykh Abdul Salam rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatullahi wasa'a. وأما تخصيص الأصوليين السنة وأما تخصيص الأصوليين للسنة بأنها المطلوب طلبا جازما طلبا غير جازم فهذا اصطلاح طارئ إنما قصدوا به التمييز بينهما أو بينها وبين الفرض والواجب أو الواجب. So the Sheikh says now, as for the terminology that the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh use when they're talking about Sunnah, then they've only said this in order to differentiate when they're talking about sunnah, where they say that it is the command that we have not been commanded with obligation to do. For example, Salatul Duha and so on, Salatul Witr and so on. He says that this is a new terminology. And they only intended by this terminology, or they only wanted to differentiate between that which is wajib and that which is sunnah. As you know, when it comes to the word sunnah, the scholars of hadith have a different meaning, and the scholars of the fuqaha have a different meaning, the usuliyun have a different meaning, and so on. And the scholars of aqidah have a different meaning to a sunnah. So for example, the muhaddithun, those scholars that deal with hadith, specialize in hadith, Imam Muslim, Bukhari, and so on, that you will find Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, and so on. They will talk about the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the sense that it is everything that has been narrated from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from words, actions, those things that he agreed with that were done in his presence and he knew of, his character, his appearance. All of these are considered Sunnah according to the Muhaddithun. According to the Fuqaha, according to those the Fuqaha, the Sunnah is something that if you do, you will be rewarded for. Like, if you leave out, you won't be sinning, you won't be punished for. As for the Usuliyun, they say that the Sunnah, or the angle that they look at the Sunnah from, is that which ahkam, rulings, can be deprived from. For example, they only look at the statements of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his actions sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his taqrirat, everything that he agreed with that was done in his presence or in his era. So they will only look at Sunnah from this angle. So it's a bit more specific than the Muhaddithun. As for the books of Aqidah, and I won't say the scholars of Aqidah, because the scholars of Aqidah are the Fuqaha, they are the Muhaddithun, they are the Usuliyun. Lakin, the books of Aqidah, when the word Sunnah is mentioned, then it is everything that opposes the Bid'ah. It is the Qasim, or the opposite of a Bid'ah. So Bid'ah and Sunnah. So when you say Usul Sunnah Imam Ahmed, when you hear Usul Sunnah Imam Ahmed, or Sunnah, for the belonging to the son of Imam Ahmad rahmatullah alayhi, or any other book, Kitab al-Sunnah, or Sharh al-Sunnah, all of these are a hadith, or they deal with the belief, the aqidah of the Salaf. So when we look at these books of aqidah, if they're entitled a sunnah li fulan al-khalal and so on, we don't say they deal with sunnah prayers and nawafil and so on. No. They deal with the aqidah of the Salaf. Why? Because what is meant by this sunnah is everything that is under the belief of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and everything that contradicts the bid'ah that those people, the innovators, have innovated into the Sharia of Islam. So when the Sheikh is saying that we give importance to the sunnah, it means from every aspect. So we don't say it's only a sunnah. The difference between us and the companions is that they did the actions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam because it was a sunnah. We leave actions out because it's a sunnah. That's the difference. They acted according to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam because it was the sunnah of the Messenger. And we leave out the sunnah of the Messenger because it's only a sunnah, wal-iyadu billah. طيب. For sunnah to be lisan al-shari', when the sunnah is mentioned in the words of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إذا أطلقت يراد بها الطريقة الشرعية التي كان عليها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في عباداته ومعاملاته وأخلاقه وحركاته وسكناته. So when the word sunnah is mentioned in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it is everything that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in terms of ibadah, in terms of his dealings, his transactions, his dealings with people, and his manners and his character, and every aspect of his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يقول عروة بن زبير رحمة الله عليه رضي الله عنه. He said, السنن السنن فإن السنن قوام الدين. أي إلزم السنن فإن السنن قوام الدين. أي hold on to the sunnah, the sunnan, hold on to the sunnan, for verily the sunnan are the foundations, and they are the backbone of the religion. وكان ابن عمر رضي الله عنه وكان ابن عمر رضي الله عنه يتبع أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وآثاره وحاله ويتهم به حتى أنه خيف على عقله من اهتمامه بذلك كما أخرجه أبو نعيم وغيره رحمة الله عليه رحمة واسعة. So ابن عمر رضي الله عنه, knowing that ابن عمر رضي الله عنه, عبد الله بن عمر, he used to follow the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم sunan. He used to follow the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in detail, to the extent that people feared for his sanity, to the extent that people feared for him, to the extent that people say he went blind because of him implementing the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, making sure the water was inside his eye and so on. To the extent that if the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam akramakumullah urinated in a certain place, he would also do the same. Or if the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam took a certain path, he would follow that specific path, sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa radiyallahu anhu. ويقول الزهري إمام الزهري رحمة الله عليه said, he was one of the تابعون, he says كان ممن مضى من علمائنا from those that preceded us from our scholars, they would say, Al-i'tisamu bi sunnati najat. Following and holding on to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a najat, is safety, is safety. And the Sheikh says, قال الشيخ وللاهتمام بسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فوائد كثيرة ولا تحصى. And there are many benefits in sunnah, in the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he only mentions a few. منها تحصيل الملتزم بها درجات المحبوبية التي قال الله سبحانه وتعالى قال الله عز وجل فيها كما في الحديث القدسي ولا يزال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه فإذا أحببته كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به. So the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, or the Sheikh says, from the benefits of following the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that a person will attain the love of Allah. Following the Messenger's sunnah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will help you attain the love of Allah jalla wa ala. How? Allah says in the Hadith al-Qudsi that my servant will not cease to draw closer to me. My servant will continue to get closer to me bin nawafil, with supplicatory acts, with voluntary acts, hatta uhibba, until I love him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who Allah jalla wa ala loves. So by following the sunnah of the Messenger, by doing these sunan, for example, the witr prayer, the duha, salatul duha, for example, fasting Mondays and Thursdays and so on, by doing these sunan, we're getting closer to Allah and we're getting or attaining the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah says, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ, and if I love this servant, كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ, I become his hearing, the hearing that he hears with. وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يُبْصِرُ بِهِ, and I become the seeing that he sees with. وَرِجْلَهُ الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا, and his walking that he walks with. وَيَدَهُ الَّتِي يَبْطِشُ بِهَا, and his word, his striking, his hand that he strikes with. وَإِنْ سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّ, and if he asks, then I shall give. وَلَئِنْ اسْتَعَاذَنِي لَأُعِيذَنَّ, and if he seeks refuge in me, then I shall give him refuge. So all of these virtues are by way of following the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's not hard. When you pray Isha at night, after pray, you can pray two rak'at as a ratiba to rectify your, as we shall see, to rectify your fard prayer. Also praying witr, it can be one rak'ah. It can be three rak'at, five. It doesn't have to be 20 or 25. It can be one rak'ah. That one rak'ah can be a reason for Allah Jalla wa Ala loving you. The Sheikh says, وَمِن فَوَائِدِ تَمَسُكِ بِالسُّنَّةِ, and from the benefits of following the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, أَنَّهَا تُجْبِرُ الْفَرَائِدَ, that it complements and it fixes and restores the, and it completes the faraid, the wajibat. How? لِقَوْلِ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, because we see in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا يُحَاسِبُ النَّاسُ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مِنْ أَعْمَالِهِمْ, from their acts. The first thing that people will be tested upon and asked about from their actions is as-salah, is the prayer. فَيَقُولُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ, Allah will say to his angels, أُنْظُرُوا لِصَلَاةِ عَبْدِي, look at the salah, meaning the faraid, the wajibat of my servant. أَتَمَّهَا أَمْ نَقَصَهَا, is it complete or has he completed them or is there deficiency in them? فَإِنْ كَانَتْ تَامَةً كُتِبَتْ لَهُ تَامَةً, if it is complete, then it is written that it is complete for him. وَإِنْ كَانَ انْتَقَصَ مِنْهَا شَيْءٌ, لَكِنْ, if there is some sort of deficiency in it, if there is some sort of deficiency in it, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى أُنْظُرُوا هَلْ لِعَبْدِي مِنْ تَوْطَوْعٍ, then look, if there is deficiency in the prayer of the person, then Allah Jalla wa Ala will say to these angels, look into the sunan, the voluntary supererogatory acts of my servant. فَإِنْ كَانَ لَهُ تَطَوْعٌ, and if he does have supererogatory acts, if he does do sunan, and they are written down for him, قَالَ أَتِمُّ لِعَبْدِي فَرِيدَتَهُ مِنْ تَطَوُّعِهِ, Allah Jalla wa Ala will say, complete for my servant his wajibat. The fard that he was, that was deficient with him, then complete it for him. How? By adding on to it using his voluntary acts. Likewise, the salah, the five daily prayers. No one can say that they pray the salah every day at its correct time. No one can say they meet all of the conditions and all of the pillars and all of the sunan of the salah. We're bound to sometimes pray without having wudu. We're bound to sometimes make mistakes in the salah. We're bound to make mistakes we're bound to accidentally pray late at the incorrect time of the salah. Therefore, all of these deficiencies are completed and restored by praying sunan,
Sunnah acts. ومنها, and from the benefits of acting upon the Sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, أن للمتمسك بالسنة في آخر الزمان أجرا كبيرا, that the person who implements the Sunnah and acts according to the Sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم towards the end of time, there is a great reward. لحديث عتبة رضي الله عنه, in which he said, عتبة غزوان, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, إن من ورائكم أيام الصبر, verily behind you, or verily there are أيام الصبر, there are days that will come that require patience, much patience. للمتمسك فيهن يومئذ بما أنتم عليه أجر خمسين منكم. للمتمسك فيهن يومئذ بما أنتم عليه أجر خمسين منكم. For the person that holds on to the sunnah during those days of patience, he will attain the reward of 50 of you. قال يا نبي الله, يا نبي الله. They said to him, oh, يا رسول الله. أو منهم, do you mean from them? قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, بل منكم, بل rather from you. So the person who acts according to the sunnah of the messenger and who hold on to the sunnah of the messenger will gain much reward. Lakin it should not be understood from this hadith that we are more virtuous than the companions of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For verily the companions were people who were promised paradise once they were on earth. They were people who Allah said in the Quran, radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhum, they are pleased with him. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with him. Also Allah jalla wa ala chose them, those companions, to be the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So just like the Messenger was chosen by Allah jalla wa ala, then these companions were chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore in that we see the misguidance of those who insult and belittle the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and those who say they fell into apostasy after the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wal iyad billah. وقد كان السلف رحمة الله عليهم أجمعين, and the Salaf used to say, oh, كانوا يشددون في ترك بعض السنة أو يلومون تاركها مطلقا. So if they, the Salaf, they used to be harsh and stern towards the person who would leave off the Sunnah, and they would criticize the person who left off all of the Sunnah. لأنه قد يتناوله عموم قوله سبحانه وتعالى فما عموم قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فما رغب عن سنتي فليس مني. So the reason why they would criticize is because that may have, or that may come under the general meaning of the hadith of the messenger, that for man raghiba an sunnati, the one who leaves off my sunnah, falaysa minni, then he is not from me. فَلِذَلِكَ قَالَ إِلِيمَامَ أَحْمَدَ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, and because of this, Imam Ahmad said, رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, مَنْ تَرَكَ الْوِتْرَ, the one who leaves off witr, فَهُوَ رَجُلُ سُوءٍ, then he is an evil man. لَا يَنْبَغِي أَنْ تُقْبَلَ لَهُ شَهَادَةً. And تُقْبَلَ لَهُ شَهَادَةٌ, it is not befitting that his testimony is accepted. So that was the time of Imam Ahmad, where he would say that a person who opposes or who leaves off the witr salah, which is a sunnah, then we can't take his testimony. Obviously those days and the level of those, the people in the time of Imam Ahmad and the level of the people nowadays is completely different. فَكُلُّ مَا ثَبَتَ مِنْ سُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, so everything that has been authentically narrated in the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, نَسْعَى سَعْيًا شَدِيدًا لِتَطْبِيقِهِ وَتَعْلِيمِهِ لِلنَّاسِ, we strive in acting upon it and we strive in teaching it to the people. لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى, it may be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَنْ يَهَبَنَا أَجْرًا مَنْ أَحْيَى السُنَنَ, it may be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon us the sunnah, the reward of the one who revives the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ila huna wallahu ta'ala a'lam wa ahkam wa billahi tawfiq.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi. So we've got one question here. Question is asking, if I open a social account for purpose of business and also speak about Islam in relation to business topic, but not about Tawheed first, because the main purpose is not to give the da'wah, is that okay or not? And if not, how should I go about it?
Repeat the question, please.
So the person's asking, if he opens a social account for I think it means social media, for purpose of business, but sometimes he puts stuff in relation to Islamic rulings on business, but he doesn't start with Tawheed. He says, is this, or how can you go about it?
Allahu a'lam. La adik, Allahu a'lam. Lakin I would say to him, just as a side benefit, and this isn't an answer to the question because I said la adli, like, as a side benefit to him or to this individual, is that they don't try taking advantage of the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just to sell your product. So you will find people, they want to sell their product and they come with a hadith that don't actually refer to their product, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam are not referring to their specific topic. That's why during the time of the Salaf, one of the reasons when, or the times when fabricated a hadith came around, the hadith that are mawdu'a, you would find that there were people that, for example, to the extent that if they wanted to sell pineapple, if they wanted to sell watermelons, they would make up a hadith and say, "Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, man ishtara al-badiyah kada law kada wa kada wa kada." The one that sells this fruit, buys this fruit, or sells this fruit for him is the reward of such and such. And they would mention different health benefits and so on. So, just to be careful on that note, to not take advantage of the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to buying or selling. Like, it is important that if a person is buying or selling, it's important that they know that ahkam bi'u, the rule is to do with buying or selling. Wallahu a'lam.
Tayyib, another question. When studying a book, should I buy the explanation of the book or the actual mutun?
When you're studying a book, when you want to buy a book, there's a new method, and if there's a new book that's starting, teachers starting a new book, if you can buy the explanation, it's good, buy the explanation, because it saves you having to buy the explanation later on. So by buying the explanation, you've got the matan and the explanation, two in one. Whereas if you buy the matan, somewhere along the line, you're going to need the sharh, the explanation. So it's better to buy the copy with the explanation. However, when you're studying a book, it's extremely important to give importance to the matan, the hadith, the words of the author himself. Don't busy yourself with the sharh and the explanation. So for example, if you're studying Usul al-Thalatha for the very first time, and you're going to a new lesson, read the matan of the hadith, the matan of Imam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahmatullah alayhi. The word is "A'lam rahimakallah annahu yajib alayna ta'allum abu al-masl." Read the matan before the class. Before you go to the class, read the matan. And then obviously you're going to study the matan. Give importance to the matan. Like, in the mistake that a lot of students, some students make, is that they get the matan and they look into the explanation before being well grounded in the matan itself, the word is of the author. Because if the matan, if the author says, for example, if we look at the explanation of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, where the Sheikh says, "I'lam rahimakallah," Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala probably explains that in two or three pages, or at least a page and a half or two. So you, as a student who's starting off, you're now going into the ocean of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala in the explanation. Whereas if you're looking into the matan, it's easy for you to understand. And there are levels to seeking or to learning a book. So to understand the matan first and then moving over to the explanation. Another mistake that many students make is they go to different explanations. When you're studying a book, don't go to five different explanations or three different explanations. Stick to one explanation and understand that explanation. Understand the matan, be well grounded in the matan, and then move over to the sharh or the explanation, and do so more than one occasion. Wallahu a'lam.
Tayyib, I have another question. How to advise someone whose da'wah core is not based upon tawheed, but is based upon calling to good deeds, etc., and they downplay the importance of tawheed?
And the question being, how do you advise the person whose core da'wah calling is where they call to fadail a'mal or virtues of doing good deeds, and it degrades tawheed? That person, it's enough that he has opposed the guidance of the Salaf. the Salaf used to give importance before the Salaf. They have opposed the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to the people of Mecca, he started off by calling to the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For 13 years, he spent in Mecca calling to the Tawheed of Allah. The Salah that we pray every day now, 5 times a day, was only made wajib in the 10th year of prophethood. The Messenger gave these first 10 years the importance to, he gave his importance and his attention to Tawheed. And he carried on, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even when he moved over to Al-Madinah. Therefore, for the person who says, I'm only going to give importance to Fadail A'mal, or encouraging the people to pray 5 times a day, or encouraging the people to fast Mondays and Thursdays, encouraging the people to have good akhlaq, all of these are excellent. Yani it's from the religion, mashallah alayk. Lakin, Tawheed comes before all of this. For example, if a person has the best of character, he has noble manners, lakin he's worshipping other than Allah Jalla wa Ala, will that benefit him in the least? La, it won't benefit him. Lakin the opposite, if a person has awful manners, and this is an encouragement, it's not an encouragement to have awful manners, lakin if a person happens to have awful manners, lakin their tawheed is sound, then that tawheed will benefit them. Yawma la yanfa'u malun wa la banun, on the day that neither sons or wealth will avail or will help a person. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ, except for the person that comes to Allah with a sound heart. And the only way a person can come to Allah Jalla wa Ala with a sound heart is if they call to the Tawheed of Allah, if they implement the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they call to the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's that person whose da'wah is not on based upon Tawheed, they should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow the guidance of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our noble messenger, was sent to you just like he was sent to everyone else. So just like you pray according to the sunnah of the messenger, then call the people to, or call in the way, in the methodology of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was to start with rectifying the tawheed, the belief of the Muslims. If a person, even in Jahiliyyah, I believe it was Ibn Jud'an or Ibn Jud'an, I believe it was, and a man named Ibn Jud'an, or he had a name, ala kulli hal, along those lines. Aisha radiallahu anha said to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asked the Messenger about this individual. And she said he was very generous in Jahiliyyah. He was very generous and so on. So will he go into Jannah? And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ya Aisha, verily he never said on one occasion, he never said, oh Allah, forgive me for my sins. I mean, he didn't have belief in Allah Jalla wa Ala. He didn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's important that a person starts off his da'wah with calling to the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's something that, yani, it's just from the fitna of the zaman, it's from the fitna of our era and the fitna of social media, where you find the person having hundreds of followers or maybe thousands of followers, and it's just kalam farigh. They're talking nonsense. That's absolute nonsense. They don't have knowledge, and they're not calling to the sunnah of the messenger, and they're not calling to the sunnah according to how the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. However, you find them coming out and, you know, open up social accounts, social media accounts, they should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that they will be held to account for that. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam wa ahkam wa billahi tawfiq.
Two last questions on the table. Right. How do you become well grounded in the matan?
How do you well become well grounded in the matan? By studying it, by reading it, studying it under a sheikh, under a teacher. Knowledge cannot be taken by reading books alone. You have to have a teacher. A person without a teacher, if you say you want to seek knowledge without a teacher, is equivalent to you saying, I want to learn how to drive without a driving instructor. Just like you need a driving instructor to learn how to drive, you need a teacher when you want to seek Islamic knowledge. وَأْتُ الْبُيُوتَ مِنْ أَبْوَابِهَا. Everything has an entrance point. The entrance point to al-ilm, obviously fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know, having ikhlas and so on. From that is having a teacher. If a person doesn't have a teacher, they're going around the circles. They will make silly mistakes. So you have to have a teacher. This teacher will teach you this matter. he will teach you the meaning of the author. What does the author mean by saying i'lam rahimakallah annahu yajibu alayna, it is wajib upon us? What sort of wajib is he talking about? What does wajib mean? What does ilm mean? So the teacher will teach you this. Once the teacher teaches you this, then you will go home and you will review what the teacher has mentioned, all of the fawaid, the benefits that you've taken. And also you need to write in the class. When you're in class, you need to write. So for example, if you've got a lesson on Saturdays, every Saturday you have a Tawheed class, the Surah Thalatha. Before Saturday, review that book. Whether it's Thursday, Friday, review the book. Even Saturday morning, review the book. The part that you feel that's that the teacher is going to teach. Then go to the lesson. And obviously you're going to study it with the sheikh. So that's two times that you've studied that matter now. Then go home. Or once they're in class, when you're in class, pay attention. Don't look at your sheikh, the explanation. Look at or listen to the explanation of the ustad. Write it down. Write the benefits that you have. If you go to a class, you need to write your notes down in a pen, using a pen and a book, not phones. Some students use laptops. That's fine. If they're fast typers, then it may be even better if they, obviously for them it might be better because they later on they can print it out and so on. And there won't be any typos. Later on, they can obviously use it for exams. Lakin, in class, make sure you take notes down, not on a phone, because the teacher might think you're using the phone for personal use. Lakin, use a pen and a paper in class, take the notes down. When the lesson ends and you go home, review that class in the same evening. When you go home, or the next day, make sure you review what you've studied. Now that's three times you've studied this book. And then during the week, make sure you review it once again. And it doesn't have to be 1 hour, 2 hours, but 20 minutes, half an hour. Just look at the benefits that were mentioned, the wordings of the matin, the person, the imam, the author of the book and so on. And the benefits that your teacher mentioned. This is four times that you've studied this book now. You would be well grounded in that. And if a teacher is holding exams, taking tests, which I encourage all teachers, all of the students of knowledge who are teaching in the UK and any other place they may be, to hold exams and tests. Because if a person is tested on a certain book, they will give it their undivided attention and they will review it and revise it and memorize it and so on and understand it better. So make sure you give your students a test. Or what you can sometimes do is encourage them to summarize the book or a certain chapter into their own words. So if your teacher takes tests, then before the test, you're obviously going to review this book. Now that's five times you've studied this book. You've studied this book or this specific lesson, you've reviewed it five times. Then you can move on to the next book. The next step might even be you teaching this book after being well-grounded in it. So that's how you become well-grounded in it. There's no pill that you take that gives you knowledge. Knowledge is only you only gain knowledge by sitting down, by reviewing, memorizing, reading, and so on, and attending classes. That's how you get well grounded in knowledge. And there are books that you can read when it comes to seeking knowledge. There are books that you read when it comes to seeking knowledge, because seeking knowledge is a skill and a science of itself. In of itself, it's a science. For example, you can read Hadith Talul Ilm, the etiquettes or the adornments of the seeker of knowledge, or actually Sheikh Bakr Ghazali rahimahullah, or Kitab al-Ilm, the book of knowledge by Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala rahmatullah wasi'ah. So learn how to seek knowledge before you seek knowledge. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam wa ahkam.
If possible, could you confirm if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the dua, "Oh Allah, bless us in Rajab and Sha'ban and allow us to reach Ramadan"? Is this authentic?
Allahu A'lam.
One last question. Can we leave? Can we learn off sheikhs of YouTube?
Can we learn off
sheikhs of YouTube? sheikhs on YouTube, well, or sheikhs, the so-called sheikhs.
The thing is, when you're the question is vague. Sheikh Fawzan is on YouTube at the moment. Sheikh Al-Abad Hafidhullah is on YouTube. Albani ibn Baz ibn Uthaymi, you can find their lessons on YouTube. However, I believe the questioner is referring to those people who have all of a sudden, without seeker knowledge, have just opened YouTube accounts and the next day they are Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhi. When a person is seeking knowledge, I'll give you a general principle. When a person wants to seek knowledge, they should be careful who they seek knowledge from. In هَذَا الْعِلْمَ الدِّينِ فَانْظُرُوا عَمَّنْ تَأْخُذُونَ دِينَكُمْ. Verily, this knowledge is religion. So be careful who you take your religion from. So when you're seeking, when you want to seek knowledge or when you want to study under a person, you need to know that this person is qualified enough. You need to know that this person is a alim or student of knowledge. You need to know where they have sought knowledge, where they have learnt. You need to know who they studied under. You need to know that this person is worthy of teaching qala Allah wa qala Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now there are many students of knowledge in the UK, walillahi alhamdu wal minna. I encourage you to benefit from those students of knowledge who have gone abroad, whether it's to the Islamic University of Medina, whether it's of the Islamic University of Imam Muhammad bin Saud al-Islamiyah, or Umm al-Qura, or other universities, or the University of Qasim, or whether it's those students who have studied in Yemen, in the different maraqis of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, then I encourage you to learn from them and go to their lessons and attend their classes. Because when you look at their classes, they don't only teach Qala Allah, Qala Rasul, they teach Usul al-Thalatha, Kitab al-Tawhid, Qawa'id al-Arba'ah, Kashf al-Shubuhat, Usul al-Sunnah, and so on. They'll teach books of fiqh, different madahib, they'll teach usul al-fiqh, they'll teach qawa'id al-fiqhiyyah, they'll teach you a lot of sciences from the sciences of al-Islam. However, there are people who, they're not du'at, they're not callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I would say they're calling to themselves. There are people who are not callers. They kind of, they just open up a YouTube account because it's free to do so, and a Twitter account because it's free to do so, and an Instagram account because it's free to do so. And their sole purpose is to attain followers. And the reason why I say this is because when a person wants to talk in the name of Islam, they need to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they need to have knowledge. Some people have made their purpose. They've made their purpose when calling to whatever they're calling to, in refuting a certain group of people. That's their purpose in life. So where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have not created insan and jinn except that they worship me. It's as if this person is saying, my sole purpose is to refute the Jamiyyah. My sole purpose is to refute the Madakhila, what they call the Madakhila or the Jamiyyah, which are names that don't exist, groups that don't exist. That's their sole purpose. They don't know the Arabic language. They don't know the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have no knowledge. They've never studied anywhere. However, by picking up different books, they somehow believe they are shuyukh. And they somehow believe that they can talk and they're an ambassador for al-Islam. When in reality, they're contradicting the guidance of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because you can only teach what you know. If you've never studied, for example, these people that have these accounts, you can't study under them. What are you going to study? Billahi alaykum, let's be honest with ourselves. What are we going to study? Say we wanted to study under these YouTube sensations. What are we going to study? How to swear? How to speak broken Arabic? How to recite the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a broken manner? How to fight? What are we going to learn from them? What are you going to learn from them? Nothing. You're not going to learn manners. You're not going to... فَالْقَدُ الشَّيْلَا يُعْطِي. If a person doesn't have something, he can't give. Zakat is only wajib upon the one who has wealth. If a person doesn't have knowledge, what are you going to learn from him? So stay away from these social media platforms. Stay away from watching these videos that are a waste of time. If you look into these social media sensations and ulama and shuyukh al-Islam, you will find that they will talk about a random topic which is obviously controversial and eye-catching, within a day or two, probably get 50,000 views. And now, look into the lessons of Sheikh Al-Abbad, hafidhahullah. Look into the lessons of Sheikh Salih Al-Fawzan, hafidhahullah. Look into the lectures and the fatawa of Ibn Uthaymeen and Al-Bani and Ibn Baz, rahmatullahi alayhi majma'in. 10, 5,000, 200 people, 300, 20 people. Why? Because these people are qutta' tariq. They are highway robbers. They have placed a barrier, a hijab, between the scholars and the students and the common people. So people are now watching them talking about ridiculous topics just for the sake of views, just for the sake of views. So they need to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they need to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question them and how they are. There's an angel writing their deeds and whatever they're saying. So they should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they should seek knowledge and then teach. Seek knowledge and then teach. As for others, you can't really learn anything from them anyway. Like, learn from the scholars. Their lessons are, alhamdulillah, on YouTube. You'll find any subject, any science, any scholar, you will find it online. And also benefit from the students of knowledge that have come back to the UK. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam wa ahkam.
JazakAllah khair.